Every day this never-ending pressure tries to take its claim over my heart. I have tried to hold it all together, but time and time again I fall apart. But that's where I find my life was never mine at all. But you are the one inside, always in control. So when it feels like all of this pain is never gonna end, fall to my knees by all of these things I don't understand, don't understand. Truth that's healing me, knowing I can trust you is a treasure. With eyes wide open now I finally see, it's here that I find my life was never mine at all. You're still the one inside, always in control.
Thank you. thank God for doctors, and we know they're doing a good job, and we thank them that they're taking care of you. But we want to take your name before the great physician. And not only Ken, but leave us your prayer request, and we're going to pray for all of you. But everybody pray for Ken Jackson, please, in your prayers. Every time when you get talk to the Lord, remember her and lift her up. And Tom Ford as well. Please pray for Tom Ford and his family. God knows all about that, and he really, really needs a touch. So, but again, welcome, and we're glad to have everybody, a few of us out tonight. But we thank the Lord for the few that can come out and be in the house of the Lord. We'll go right on and do the best we can. I try to go on just like there's 1,000 people here. I don't think we can social distance with 1,000, but and there's not, don't worry, there's not 1,000 here tonight. So, but anyway, I don't know if anybody got anything you want to share with the Lord about the Lord tonight. Jerry shared a testimony. The Lord's blessed him before we come on the air. He shared that. Anybody else wants to share a testimony or anything tonight? I don't believe I can sing on my own. You all probably don't want to hear that tonight. we might just do our Bible study and call it an evening. So, but anytime you have something to say for the Lord, you sure can, for sure. Anybody, somebody might want to come up and sing. I don't know. We're waiting on Dave, man.
We've got a good singer here. We got to pop you up.
Reckon we get the family on the front row and sing here?
Hey,
good
idea.
Oh, good. Yeah,
if Rick can teach Jamie how to run that back there, somebody can teach him to play guitar.
Yeah, he knows that though. Yeah, he can do it. I guarantee it. Anyway, again, it is good to be with you. We'll do our Bible study tonight. I'm sure that the Lord, His word is always on time. It's always just what we need. It'll fit our situations if we'll just allow Him to speak to us. And so we are in Genesis 38, and I believe Jamie had a start at 10, and I think he's right. That's exactly about where we left off. So Genesis 38 and 10, I want to say again, hi to all our church family, anybody that may be watching, we love you and miss you, and we can't wait till things get a little better. We've been together on a regular basis. So we're in Genesis 38, 10, and this is kind of a break from the story of Joseph, and we get a story of some things that don't go exactly right here. We've said time and time and time and time again in these Bible studies, and I stand by it, that I'm glad that God didn't leave the tough stuff out. I'm glad, Brother Jack, because that's where I'm at, you know, and this book's not a fairy tale. It does end happily ever after for those that are born again. But it's not a fairy tale. God did not leave out the rough stuff. He put those in there and he included it. And again, to me, I say all the time, that just encourages me even more of the authenticity of God's word. Because a lot of people, when they want to convince you to persuade you of something, they really just tell you the good stuff. They don't tell you all. But this is a whole picture, and it points to Christ. And I love how, what Brett shared with us. I don't know who it all got to hear that last week. He's back there taking care of the sound and all that stuff. But the comment that he made was completely out of my track of thinking when he talked about when these people displeased the Lord and they got so wicked that God just slew them. And how that... Looking towards Jesus, there was no remedy for that. There was no remedy for that wickedness. You couldn't keep the law. You had to, you know, sacrifice daily and then once a year just to stay your sins. But looking towards Jesus, who could remedy these situations? Who could take the wickedness and spread grace and love and mercy over it? And I just thought about that all week. And that was really maybe the best part of that whole lesson, in my opinion, last week. So anyway, we're talking about some crazy stuff going on in the family. Judah, the older brother, has went down to the land of Canaan, which, again, was tough stuff, really caused them problems. Took a lady there, married a lady there, and had children. And it ended up problem after problem. son's dying. And so verse 10 starts off, and it just kind of says the same thing we talked about Onan, the second brother. Ur was the first one. And Onan, the thing which he done displeased the Lord, wherefore he slew him also. And we talked about, we had a little discussion about birth control and how that really, we didn't think was the, overall was the focus of that. In other words, the reason he was judged was because he disobeyed what the plan was. And that happens every time. So then verse 11 says, then said Judah to Tamar, his daughter-in-law. Now, keep in mind, she was married to Ur, then she was married to Onan. Both of them died, and remember we talked about the plan, what it was at that time? You married the brother to carry on the family name. So there's another brother named Shelah. We talked about that. We thought maybe they wanted to have a girl. But this brother's name was Shelah, and this was Judah's, Shelah. And this brother was the last of the brothers out of this relationship. And Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, you remain a widow at thy father's house till Shelah or Shelah, whatever that is, my son be grown. For he said, lest peradventure he die also as his brother did. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. So here's the dad, Judah, saying, wait a minute. Two husbands, two of my sons died. This Tamar, I don't know about her. I don't think I want to be in such a hurry to see my third son in a marriage with her. Right, Jerry? I mean, that's what he was saying. He said, so let's not immediately do that. Let's just... you go back to your dad's house, and when the time's right, we will. That marriage will take place. In his heart, I don't think ever with an intention of really carrying out. And again, so we get disobedience again. We get a failure to follow the plan. And guys, and here's the deal. We look at what a mess this has become. But it all goes down back to the very first verse. It all goes back to the decisions we make and the people that we're involved with. Now, that's a true thing. I mean, God will forgive us. Certainly He will for the decisions we make. Certainly for making the wrong choices. God will forgive us for that. But on the same hand, there still can be repercussions for the choices that you make. We don't like to talk about that in this day and time. In this day and time, you know, that's not really good. Everybody ought to just be all right. But listen, there's repercussions for the choices we make in life. And you can be forgiven of them. Somebody said, I owed the bank $100,000 and I've become a Christian. You still owe the bank $100,000? You know, being a Christian is about a right relationship with the Lord and doing things right and having His peace and eventually spending an eternity in heaven. But it doesn't free us from the decisions that we make. Now, God will be with us and help us with those, even when we mess up. But all of this, we're thinking about this mess. Let us not forget that it went back to Him going really to a place where He really simply went, picking up some friends that you really shouldn't have picked. And God knows these things. I've always told people, God don't keep us from sin because He's trying to keep us from some great enjoyment or great pleasure, right? God says, yeah, I don't want you to sin because sin, when it's conceived, brings forth death. It starts out with lust. I know lust, when it's conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it's conceived, it brings forth death. So what the Bible said. So God, being a good father, being a good shepherd, says, I don't want you involved with those things because it's bad for you. God's not trying to keep us. And when God said, don't go there and don't do that, and people go there and they do that, then a lot of times there's prices to be paid, penalties. And sad sometimes to see it. But so that's where we're at. Don't forget that. It said... In the process of time, the daughter of Shua's, Judah's wife, died. And so sons died, the daughters, his wife died. And Judah was comforted. And that word really means he was in the process of mourning. And he was working through that. And he was in the process of it and comforted. And he went up to his sheep shears in Timnath. It was the same place Samson went, if you study about that. He and his friend Hira, the Adullamite, which kind of got this all going in the wrong direction to begin with. And it was told Tamar, say, behold, thy father-in-law goeth up to Timnath to shear his sheep. So remember, Tamar is waiting on Shelah, the son, to grow up and have the blessings of the father and be wed to Shelah. That's what she was waiting on, Tamar was, because Judah said that's what would happen. Well, she heard that Tamar was on this journey, or that Judah was on this journey. And she put, verse 14, her widow's garments off from her and covered her with a veil and wrapped herself and sat in an open place, which is by the way to Timnath. For she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given unto him to wife. So she seen that things wasn't going the way it was promised, and she will take things into her own hands, right? And man, oh man, listen, you want to make sure everything you all got to. This is, they don't make a daytime soap opera like this. I mean, they don't. This is real life. And so she comes up with a plan and said, I'll show him, you know, and boy, wait till you see how this goes. And you all help me be thinking, what practical stuff can we talk about in this? If the Lord puts something on your heart, please stop and let's share this and talk about it, because it won't be a blessing and help to people as we read God's word. So she says, okay, I'll take off my widow's garment. And the clothes was so... You could tell so much about people in that day. We've overlooked that a lot. You could tell so much about people by the clothes that they were wearing. That blind Bartimaeus in the New Testament, when the Bible said as he moved towards Jesus, he laid aside his garment. We've talked about that a lot. The garment that he had would have been a garment that people recognized that somebody that was in need would have been wearing, a beggar or something like that. So when he laid that garment off, it was very significant. And they had garments for mourning, the widow's garment here. They would have recognized that. So she wasn't going to go out in her widow's garment because she would have been recognized. So she says, I'm not going to do that. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face. I read a lot about this. And listen, this Canaanite land was a very, very, very evil, idolatrous. They followed after so many gods. And so many of their gods had to do with sexuality and things of that nature. So they had what they called temple prostitutes. They had, that's what they had. So she has kind of disguised herself up as like one of those prostitutes. And they would recognize that by the garments that she wore. And that's how they got converts. These women would go out and they would proposition these fellows. And then they would, and then they would convert to whatever crazy religion. So look where Judah has gone from look where Joseph, they plotted to murder Joseph, then decided, we'll just sell him so the blood won't be on our hands. And then the next thing you know, we see Judah going down. And down, and down, and down. He got away from the Father's house. And that's what happens to every one of us, guys. That, it may not be this significant, you may say, or it may not be this serious, or I may not have done that, but the truth of the matter is, when we are out of the will of the Lord, when we are away from Father's house, we go down and down and down and down every time.
His direction changed when he becomes jealous.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Can it all really go back to jealousy?
Yeah.
This has ruled his whole life, baby. And not only his, I'm sure the other brothers, we're going to read something about that, but that's a great point. All could go back to jealousy, and we talked about jealousy being crueler than the grave, the Bible said, and not dealing with it. And this is what happened with you guys, and I know, like I said, just a few of us here tonight, but even somebody watching, or maybe one of us here tonight or more. But this is a direct result, hear me on it, or hear the Lord on this, through his word. This is what you're seeing, this downward spiraling, out of control deal, is always a result of not taking care of the problem in the first place. Jack, I might have said it a long time ago, we talked about back in the day, you could go to these little local grocery stores and you could say, put that on my bill. And the worst thing you can do, credit cards, any type of things like that, the worst thing that you can do, a lot of times physically and spiritually, is to let your account go a long time without reconciling it, right? So Jack said a long time ago, I believe, keep a short account with God. In other words, make sure you're in constant communication with God and taking care of things as they come up. If you don't do that, man, it will take you down and take you down. I've lived and I know. What's that?
The interest gets
way too high if you don't keep the account short and taken care of. So, you know, if it's an issue, if it's something that you need to get straightened out with God, just, hey, get on your knees and talk to the Lord and say, God, help me. If it's an issue with a brother or a sister, don't let it go. Don't let it spiral, because it'll go down and down and down, and then there'll be damage that is so hard to come back from. So, and that's where all this started from. Jerry says a very good point. Quite possibly, everyone it is, every bit of this come back really has a root of jealousy in it. And, well, that's sad, ain't it? That's sad. So, listen what happened. You are not going to believe this. When Judah saw her, verse 15, he thought her to be a harlot because she covered her face. Verse 16 says, and he turned unto her by the way and said, go to, I pray thee, let me come into thee. For he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law. Now this is about as tough as it gets, you know, but this was God's word. And she said, what wilt thou give me that thou mayest come into me? There's always a price to be paid for something sinful. Always. There is always a price to be paid. And I'm going to say this, not just, listen, we know, let's be honest, since the youngest one of us here, we're all adults here. Every one of us, I don't act like this sometimes, but we're adults here. And the truth of the matter is, sexual immorality is rampant in the world today. It's like, just, you know, that's just nature. And I'm saying that just happens. And listen, it's wrong. It's wrong. It's sinful. Is it something that God, yes, God will forgive you of. 100%. Yeah, 100%. Don't ever doubt that. But I'm saying what people have traded for sexual immorality, for, you know, again, I don't want to be graphic tonight, but, you know, but it's just the truth. Now, I'll say that doesn't only apply to sexual immorality. But what have we traded for a moment of self-indulgence a lot of times, or a moment of saying, well, I'm just going to do this and it'll be all right. How much have we traded away in a moment for that takes the peace of God out of our life?
decisions, your desires are really in coffee. So, and it's what he's done. He's made some bad decisions from the word go. And he keeps getting worse, but he don't know what God's plan. He don't know that.
Yeah, that's right. He don't know.
I'm saying what, you know, that's what he's done. Every decision he's made has been bad.
It's been a bad one. And it just keeps getting worse. And we're seeing in this story so many things that are really applicable to our life today. Listen, Paul said that this is not popular. I believe it probably no wonder a lot of people, we maybe not a ton of people want to hear what we, but we try to be in love, but we try to tell the truth what God's word said. But I've got to tell you this. I got to tell myself this, Brett. You might have to holler from the back there. There is some denying to do in this life.
Amen.
There, you can't act on every feeling and every emotion that you have. You say, "Well, do you have Bible?" I sure don't have Bible for that. Paul said that he had to die daily, that he had to crucify his flesh on a daily basis. That's what he said. That's what he said. Paul said, "The things that I ought not to do, I find myself right in the middle of that." And he said, "The things that I should be doing, I find myself not doing them." Now, this is Apostle Paul, wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. So what is Apostle Paul trying to tell us is that it is an effort, that there are things in our life that we have a desire for a lot of times, and I'm not talking about just sexual in nature. I'm not talking about that at all. It can be that. But there are things, guys, that we just have to say no to the flesh. That's not popular anymore, is it? That's not in this world. It's, well, you know, if it makes you feel okay, well, just go ahead and do it, man. But there's a price to be paid for that. God calls us to live a holy life. Now, we can't obviously be perfect. We're in Jesus Christ. And that's what we want God to see, is in Jesus Christ. But I'm telling you, whether you are born again, if you're watching this, whether you're a Christian or whether you're not a Christian, there is times in your life when you just have to deny yourself. And Brother Jack, there can be every reason in the world that you can give and justify and say, "Well, I want to do it." But the bottom line is, if God says it's wrong, then you have to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Christ. I know that's not popular. I know it's not. And that's why people don't want to hear these messages. But the fact of the matter is, we are wrong and God is right every time. And there's time we got to say no.
Anytime you got a question, it's wrong.
I hope you all heard that. If you've got to question it and you've got to stop and think about it and you've got to try to convince yourself, then it's wrong. It's wrong.
You know, just like Paul said, it's like you today. Now, I'm going to pick on you.
Yeah.
How many decisions have you made today that has affected a lot of people?
Yeah. 100%. You think about that.
You know, we don't realize every decision we make.
Yeah.
It don't just affect us.
Yeah.
I mean, it might be something little, but usually it affects somebody else. Maybe mom, your dad, your wife.
Yeah.
A friend.
No doubt.
No.
And not only can it affect you right now, guys, the decision you make can affect generations to come.
Yeah.
Generations. We talk about that a lot at school. Trying to help people get an education or you know, trying to help them better themselves. And we say, listen, you know, you try to give everybody every chance in the world because you're not only just affecting them, you could be affecting their whole generations. And so Jerry says, look, be careful. When you don't deny yourself, a lot of times you're opening up yourself not only just to you, well, every time, but to those that affect you're affected by and those that you affect. And so what I'm saying is, here's a private moment. Here's Judah on the road to the temple. Here is a woman that he has no idea that's really his daughter-in-law. This is really his daughter-in-law, and rather than to deny himself, man, he is about to go headlong into a terrible, terrible decision. And what he gives up. Brother Jack. What we give up when we lose our integrity. What we give up. Those are things that's hard, if ever, that you can get back. And it's sad. This is not something, this is a sad thing to see here. So let's talk about this. He says, she was a prostitute, and there's a price to be paid. He says, I'll send thee a kid from the flock. And she said, well, thou give me a pledge till you send it. In other words,
be down payment.
I want this guaranteed. If I am giving myself to you, I want a guarantee that I'm going to be paid. The devil, listen, I'm not calling her the devil, but that's exactly what the devil says. The devil says, hey, I want your pledge. I want what you got. Jack says it so many times, and we can't say it enough, that the devil came to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Well, the Bible says it. Jack just repeats it. And that is what he comes to do every time. Now, he packages it in ways like this. Yes. Oh, man, does he ever. The marketing that the devil does is unbelievable. Yeah, he can disguise alcoholism in the prettiest Budweiser. Again, I'm not singling out companies or anything like that, but in the prettiest beer commercial that you've ever seen. Alcoholism packaged up in parties and good times and friends getting together. He can package up anything, and he can package up things that will cost you your family. They look so inviting. And tonight, the message is we've got to deny ourselves sometimes. It'll be, I don't think it'll be worth it. I'm okay, and I need help. Sometimes I don't do it. I need help with it, but I'm okay with denying myself the pleasures of this world in anticipation for the joy that waits for us in just a few days in heaven. Yeah. Oh, there'll be nothing worth trading that for. There's nothing in a moment worth trading that for today. It costs you something. She said, well, yeah, you said you're going to pay me. I want something now. I want it now. And he said, that's exactly right. That's what the world wants. We want now. Instant gratification. Can't stand to be in McDonald's and getting a Big Mac for no more than 2 minutes in the line of the drive-thru. And boy, that's true. And he said, what plan shall I give thee? Now, let's talk about these few things here just for a second, and you all have your input on it. She said, I want the signet, the bracelets, and the staff that is in thine hand. Well, now, so they had a discussion about this, and they kind of haggled back and forth. No, they don't say that. You see what the Bible says here? It says, and he gave it her, and she came into her, and she conceived by him. She got pregnant. What did he give up? Let's talk about that. I think it's very worthwhile talking about those few things there. This signet, we've studied a lot about it, and Jerry's probably studied. I see he's looking about it. Some of you all, you know this. When you talk about a signet, that was generally a ring. Now, this ring was personalized. It was basically, for a lack of a better term, it was your signature. The signature, we get that. What they would do if they had a letter to send or maybe something that needed to be private or something like that, they would melt wax and put on an envelope of some sort or a paper that was folded up, parchment, and they would fold it up, and they would melt that wax, and in that wax they would put their signet, their ring. What was he giving up? What does that speak to you all about? I mean, to me, your signature, your word, your okay, is that's everything, ain't it? That was himself. In my opinion, I mean, if you sign for something, you're saying I'm responsible. It's mine. He was not going to be able to deny. And she knew that. And listen, man, oh man, I'm so glad Brother Jack said that. Because in the end, Brother Jack said he was not going to be able to say it was not me. Because she had a signature. And you know what? In the end, when it's all said and done, nobody's going to stand before God and say, it wasn't me. God's got your signature on it. He knows. He knows your heart. He knows what you're doing. There's nothing that is hid from God. So the first thing she asked for, really, Brett, was everything that he was. It was his signature, his stamp of approval. It was everything about him. You all have any thoughts on that? I mean, I don't know. Does that sound reasonable to you all too? I mean, it's important what he gave. What did he give up for this? What did he give? And what are we giving up? What are we giving? Don't we, when sin comes and we make these decisions, don't we give of ourselves? Don't it take from us? It does. It takes a little part of us.
It's like buying a new vehicle. And you buy a vehicle because you really, something you really want, the temptation is there.
Yeah. And if you take it back, it's a great analogy, Dave. If you take it back to the dealership and say, listen, I really, this payment ain't for me. I love the car, but the payment ain't for me. They're going to jerk the papers out and say, you signed for it. Listen to me, guys. This hurts my heart a little bit. You all forgive me, but honest and truly, I know that we can mess up, and Lord help me to say this right. We can slip up and make mistakes, and we're not in an all-out planned attempt to just be evil and to deceive God and deceive our family. We can do that. That can happen. We can make a mistake, get caught in a moment. I know that. But I feel like I ought to say this. Most of everything that we really do, the mistakes we make and the sins that we create, most of it, we've signed for it. I know the Bible talks about a willful sin, but can I ask you all honestly, I mean, what have we done wrong in our life that most times we didn't go into it open, eyes wide open, that we knew about it, right? I mean, I'm not saying that every time. Does that sound bad? Am I wrong about that? Most of the time I know when I'm making this decision, again, can you get caught in a moment? Yeah, you can, but I've got to say for the most part for me, I've signed on the dotted line, and I'm sorry about it. Ask the Lord forgive me. Ask you all forgive me. Yeah.
If you don't go looking for it, most of the time you really don't
want to
help
others.
But once you start,
goodness gracious. You all really should write that down. Everybody probably should write that down. You ought to take a minute and share this with everybody. What Dave said, back to the car analogy, a whole lot of times, if you won't just go looking for it, you ain't gonna get yourself in that mess. A whole lot of times we go looking, and we end up getting. Once you get to that point, and then a lot of times it's real easy to not deny yourself. And not there's anything wrong with buying a car. Dad's looking at a car. Dad, we're not saying you're sinning by getting a car. We're not. But it's a great analogy in the fact that what it costs you something. And this is what. So she said, first of all, you ain't going to be able to deny it, as Brother Jack said. I'm going to have your signature here. They're going to know this is your ring. So if you don't send me the lamb or the sheep or what the kid, I've got your ring here.
He couldn't
sign it,
right?
No.
He couldn't, no
contract. What about that? I never even thought about that. Do you hear that? For that period of time, he'd give up his ability to sign for anything.
His reputation.
What does it cost us? That's the point tonight. It will cost you. What did he give up? He gave up his reputation. He gave up his signature. He gave up himself. What else? And she said, thy bracelets. Now, I don't know what what you all think about that, but, and this might be wrong, but I may be thinking totally. You all rein me in here, but the first thing I thought about was like these athletes and movie stars, and you know, a lot of times when they interview them after a ball game or after a, you know, whatever movies, or they're on the red carpet there, and the man, you notice what they always have on. It's just me. It's, I promise you, this ain't the Bible. It's just me thinking here. But they've always got this, man, they got that, them flashy necklaces and jewelry and system rings, you know. And I just picture that in my mind. What that says to us is these are people of stature. Now, you might, I'm not saying that's what they think. Yes, that's probably a better way to say it. So this jewelry and these bracelets, it really tells who they are. It tells of their prominence. It tells of the reputation that we're talking about. And she said, I'll take that too. Where does it stop? So you kind of give away yourself. You give away your stamp of approval. You give away your integrity. And she says, well, while I'm at it, if we're really going into this, then you know, I'm going to take away your stature. I'm going to take away who you are, who you perceive that you are, and even who people perceive that you are. I think about our people, our ministers publicly who have run into crisis. You know, I think about Jimmy Swagger. And I think about some of the, again, not singling out anybody, but these are men that carried incredible persuasion with them, didn't they, Brother Jack, at a time, you know, in the 80s, and, you know, you didn't have all this internet stuff, but these guys would go and do these big crusades, and when they fall, all that goes with them. But you know what? They just got caught. They got caught. And it come to light. And what it cost them. And you think of the impact. Jerry says, you think your decisions are not. Think about the impact. There are still people today. They'll use it as an excuse. People say, well, if that's really what. And listen, Jimmy Swagger, anybody else that has fallen, I believe totally 100%. The grace of God is sufficient to pick them up and forgive them and get right on the road doing what they need to be doing. But the truth of the matter is, when those things happen, your witness is never the same. You've lost your stature. You've lost your stature. And that's the point of this. What are we losing? What are we giving up? Yeah, what's it cost you? And I'm hoping tonight that this is not a doom and gloom message. I'm hoping this lesson, I'm hoping this persuades us to look at something twice and say, is it really worth the cost? What this could cost me? And I'm telling you, Brother Jack says, if you got to think about it, if you've got to try to convince yourself, then you don't do it. Don't do it. It's not worth the cost. So, stature.
It's kind of fun. You're never satisfied.
Never.
You could have everything in the world, but you want something else.
Yeah.
It's always tempting out there.
Yes.
Because you're, I mean, you got to look at how good you are.
Yeah.
But that's not the nature of people.
It's that is 1,000,000%, I believe, the war we fight in with it. There's two things going on with us. We've got the spiritual side of us who is content with what the Lord has done in our heart and our spirit and our soul. But then there's this fight that we have. And guys, if you don't, Paul said it was a war. And I ain't got this thing totally figured out yet. And I'm still at war. And it's flesh. It's a flesh that tugs against us. That's why Paul said he has to crucify. He wasn't talking about crucifying his spirit. He said, I got to crucify the flesh. It's the flesh. He wasn't talking about hanging the flesh on a cross every day. What he was talking about was, every day I've got to say no and put this flesh to death. I've got to have the flesh die out so that the spirit can live. And Dave says it's a war that we're fighting. It's the flesh, it's the world we live in that says, and the flesh says, more, this, that. And now, let me ask you something. when we're looking at these things, what we got to decide is this meeting the needs of my flesh, or is this meeting the needs of my spirit? That's big. If you'll stop and think about that every time, I think it will help us. Is this a spiritual thing? Is this a fleshly thing? And if it's anything contrary to the Word of God, it's flesh. It is flesh. Jesus ultimately, think about this, and I know we probably talk about this stuff all night. We didn't have no singing. Here we are still here. Right? Sorry about that. But think about this. You say that, what about Jesus? The Bible said he was tempted in all manner. Everything that we would go through. You say, I don't read about this. I don't read. Listen to this. When Jesus was baptized, and I've shared this many times as illustration, I know. But when Jesus was baptized, the Bible said when he came up out of the water and God spoke from heaven, thundered from heaven, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. What a moment. But do you read what happened next? Matthew 3, I believe it is. Matthew 3. Anyway, start digging in there and looking. He was led by the Spirit, the Bible says, into the wilderness. Now listen, hear this out. 40 days, 40 nights, the Bible said he fasted. 40 days. Give me 40 minutes and I'm in trouble. 40 days and 40 nights. How important is it to deny the flesh? The devil come to Jesus at the end of that 40 days of fasting. And he come to Jesus and the very first thing he hit him with. He knew it, Brother Jack. He knew it. He knew what he'd been through. He knew what he'd seen. He'd seen him go through. And the first thing that doggone devil come to him and said was, if you're the Son of God, you see these stones here? You turn them stones into bread. Well, my goodness. That's not sexual in nature. That's not a monetary incentive or desire or... Listen, guys. Food, 40 days and 40 nights. No food. No eating. Nothing. And the devil comes the first thing, and he don't tempt him with a new chariot. He don't tempt him with a brand new donkey or whatever. He says, if you're the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Starving. Famished. Hungry. The flesh... How did Jesus, this is an illustration for us, how did Jesus handle this? The Word of God. I'm so glad that he used the Word of God. In all of these temptations, he used the Word of God. The same things you and I can use. But he said to the devil, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So what was the Lord doing and showing us here? That we can defeat a physical urge. This is not something for pleasure. This is survival. This is food we're talking about. Somebody that ate in 40 days. So what did Jesus show us as an illustration? He said, you beat the flesh by tending to the spiritual. He said, you feast on the Word of God. No, the flesh is not nowhere near as important is what the Spirit is. Because you take care of the Spirit. Man, oh man, that to me is just awesome. I need to hear that, Brother Jack. I needed to hear that encouragement, and because we're all tempted. Every one of us are. And the Bible says we all, like sheep, have gone astray, every one of us. But we've got a Savior. And we finish with this. And thy staff. She said, so I'd like your signature, and I really want your stature. And the last thing she said is, I really want the staff. Listen, the staff. What's a staff? What do you want? Anything come to your all's mind when you think about the staff in that time of the day? Or
it was special. Everybody had their own staff.
Yes, they had their, yes.
It wasn't just a
using that to defend. They use that staff to defend your back. Guys, they weren't walking down there like, you know, they had animals, wild animals, and they used that staff to defend themselves. That staff showed authority. You said, you remember when Moses, stepped in, he reached out that rod there, and God sent a wind, and the winds blew all night, and the Red Sea parted. That staff is a representation of your authority, of your power, of your defense, of your... She said, I'll take that too. She took it off. That's exactly what sin was. Listen, it's sad tonight. It is sad because we have people. We have people that have given in. And they've been stripped of everything. But listen, tonight I didn't come with a message to leave you there. I came tonight, this ain't like what we talked about right last week, where God just slew you instantly because of your transgressions and because there was no remedy. Listen, tonight there's a remedy. You don't have to be naked. You don't have to be alone. You don't have to be stripped tonight. You don't have to feel all this shame and all this guilt and all that remorse. There is a remedy for what you've given into tonight, and it's Jesus Christ. It's Jesus. What does it cost you? It's cost me my family, preacher. It's cost me my position. It's cost me my integrity. Well, I want you to know everything that you lost in that moment, you can gain back in Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus went to the cross. Because He that knew no sin became sin for us. Every bit of guilt that you feel, He felt. Every bit of shame that you feel, He felt. Every bit of hurt, every bit of remorse, I believe, Brett, that was more painful than the crown of thorns. Maybe I'm wrong in saying that. But I feel like that was more painful than the crown of thorns. I think that was more painful than the spear. I know He would pass this world than the spear, but the nails in His hands and in His feet. I believe that He never knew what it was like to feel shame, Brother Jack. He never knew what it was like to feel that regret or feel that remorse. And He never knew ultimately what it was like to be separated from the Father. And He done every bit of that on the cross. So what you're feeling tonight, He would know and offer up a remedy for where you're at tonight. So we pray that we help you to avoid that situation through the Word of God. But if it's past that and you've been in that situation, don't lose hope. You still have life and you still have blood flowing through your body. You can still repent and ask God to come to you and forgive you. If you're a Christian, ask God to forgive you and restore you. Ask God to come back into your heart and life and renew your covenant with Him if you've never been born again. Listen, ask God tonight to come into your heart and life and to forgive you of your sins. Lord, I want you to be the Lord of my life and the Savior of my life. If you'll do that tonight, He'll come in and He'll forgive you of every transgression. He'll wipe away every sin. You may still have some payments to make, but God will take away every sin and everything in your life that's separating you from Him. He wants to do that tonight. Man, I thank the Lord for us few that come out tonight and sharing in the Word of the Lord. I wouldn't have missed it for anything. I appreciate it. And I don't know, Brad, if it's all right with you guys tonight. I don't know if Kim's even watching, but she may watch it later. But I would, I don't think she would mind a bit if we ask everybody to come up tonight. All of you, everybody that's here. If you feel comfortable with it, we'll keep our mask on. And we'll gather around right here, and we're going to pray for Kim Jackson and Tom Ford tonight. I told Kim that we would have a special service, anointing service for her. So we're going to do that. We're going to leave the cameras on if it's all right, Brad. They're still on, I'm assuming. And so we're going to pray. And listen, those of you that's watching out there right now, would you pray with us for Kim Jackson and for Tom Ford tonight and all those that need a touch? But leave us a comment saying, I'm praying for them and I'm believing. I'm praying with you guys. Leave us a comment that you're praying for Kim and praying for Tom and all those that have a need tonight. And so, well, listen, I'll ask anybody, did you guys feel comfortable? Everybody wants to come up and gather around tonight. We'll come up. And I'm going to do a couple prayer cloths. Might see if we can get one to Kim. She might already have one. Huh? Is there somewhere you can get it? I believe they are. Anybody else need a prayer call to take home or anything? Okay. We do want to say this. We love you. We thank God for you watching tonight. This church loves you. We're thankful to be a part of this community. You let us know if we can help you. We're praying for you. You pray for us. And tune in if you can on Sunday. We're going to be doing our live service at 11. But if you feel like it, we got room for you. If you want to come over at 10:30 and be a part of our in-person service, we're going to start that at 10:30 Sunday. So you come over and be with us. We sure be honored to have you. You pray with us, and we'll call that our dismissal tonight. We love you. So, Donald, will you stand there for Ken, please?